best of them. Would you care, care, care for me? I love you enough to ask you again. Would you care, care, care for me? You won't be kissing me unless you care for me. Drag them to the shed and unload 6 rounds in their fucking face. This is a sacrifice. Your hotel hall won't be so vacant, and I can't tell that you ain't faking, because I take death threats like the best of them. Kill, kill for me. I love you enough to ask you again. Would you kill, kill, kill for me? You won't be kissing me unless you kill for me.
You're going to cross. Marilyn Manson knows where I live, but he doesn't send me one of those fucking cards. So anyway, that's obviously my favorite album of the year. There was tons of them. I mean, this list I had to narrow it down. But anyway, we're right here. You got to lower that radio, Rick. We got Prickly Rickly on the line because we're going to talk about The Walking Dead. But first, I want to bring up what's going on with you and this Blase Rose, or whatever her name is. Tell me a little bit about her, and then tell me what the hell is going on. There's like a Facebook thing going on here.
Yeah, this fucking shit, dude. Okay, so you remember a few months back, I wanted to interview her. You know, I asked you to try. I gave you her contact information and shit like that. I wanted to do an interview because I'm a fan of hers. Well, was. And so we never got any information back.
Right.
So I went on one day, I went on to, I think it was Instagram, and I asked her about it, and I never got a reply back. And I said, you know, I was kind of being an asshole, but I was joking. And I said, oh, I guess you're still in your own pity party because of the way Joe Bruce, a.k.a. Violent J and Psychopathic Digi, so you're not going to take any interviews. Well, she then blocks me on Instagram, but still friends with me on Facebook. So this shit just keeps going on. And I told you that I got under her skin.
I remember that. I remember. Well, yeah, I listened to some of her music, too. It's all right.
Yeah, I mean, she's not Whitney Payton. I mean,
I know she's your favorite.
Yeah, but you know, I dig her music, you know, I thought it was really cool, and I wanted to, you know, interview her, but anyhow, so since then, like, this literally happened last night. She had posted something about Psychopathic Records, and she was started dissing Twisted. Okay, as you know, I'm a big Twisted fan. You know, those guys, they're more serious, they're more musical inclined, they're more open-minded than ICP.
Yeah, they're not as big a goofballs. I mean, I like Insane Clown Posse. Like I told my wife, I was a casual fan of Twisted, but after meeting them and fucking, you know, I'm a huge fan. I was talking about my dopest fucking Twisted collection I have now. It's fucking huge. Right. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, I have everything that Twisted has ever recorded. I've been a fan since they signed with Psychopathetic. And, you know, to me, they always up their game, you know, and ICP always just stayed in this type of, like, cheesy, D-rated movie type of level. They you know, Violent J's lyrics, when they were, you know, younger, very cool. They had a message and shit, but now it's just real cheesy. And I don't know, but anyway, she started talking shit about Twisted, and, you know, I don't know if it's just because I just, you know, being a fan, I got offended by it. So, you know, I went on to her post, and I just commented. I said, you know, I told her, you know, you remind me of the abused wife that always accepts her husband to come back just because he says he's sorry.
Right.
And I said, Twisted did you so wrong, but yet you're still on their nuts.
Yeah.
And you know, and she got offended by it, so then she started talking about how Twisted is only in it for the money, and but I'm like, dude, we're all fucking musicians. We're all in it for the money.
And that's not really true. I mean that is a motivation for anybody who plays music. I mean, they want it, but those guys are big on the underground. They even say when they sign someone that they're not gonna make you a rock star, but we can sell you some CDs.
Well, and you know, and then the bitch went on to saying that, hey, apparently Twisted has these new tarot cards with each Magic Ninja Entertainment artist on them, and it has they're all the ICP devout fans are saying that they're ripping off the ICP Joker cards. No, they're not.
Oh, who cares? You know how many bands have done shit like that before?
Right.
It's dumb.
Just, this chick, man, you know, I was a fan of her, but she's going to be so just... I don't
know why she still swings from their nuts, honestly, because they dropped her. I mean, as an artist, she was signed to the label, and, you know, they dumped her, and she's still, like, obsessed with the whole thing. I mean, I don't really know, so just from what I talked to you about and what I see, you know, I did see some of the stuff on Facebook, you know, when I was looking at when you wanted to interview originally. Of course, I had to go to the Facebook page because I got to, you know, figure out what to write in the email and shit, so...
Right, and this morning, I get all these notifications on Facebook because, you know, I felt bad because I thought what I told her in the comment was a little too harsh, and I was kind of, you know, I felt like I was being an asshole to her, you know, not 100% understanding the situation of what happened.
I understand.
And then she goes on Facebook and Twitter and all this shit and starts calling out my fucking name. I'm getting all these posts, dude. I'm not even joking. That I'm a little bitch for deleting my posts and shit. The only thing I'm thinking is I was feeling sorry for your stupid ass.
That's weird. You always get into it, like, even with Chester before when the new album came out. It's great. I mean, does she know about rockmetaltalk.com?
Well, you know, and when I first started talking to her on Instagram about doing an interview, she just kept ignoring me. I put the rockmetaltalk.com out there, And it's kind of like with the Brock Lindo situation. I put the moniker out there, and I don't hear nothing back. Because Brock was like, well, what's the station that you do a segment on? I said, rockmetaltalk.com. Haven't heard anything back. But apparently in February, I'm going to be doing an exclusive one-on-one with Jarrett Reddick from Bowling for Soup. He has gotten back to me, and we're going to meet up since we live in the same county and everything. We're going to meet up, and I'm going to be doing a one-on-one interview with him. So that's coming up in February.
Nice, nice. Yeah, that's good. I mean, he's got a lot of followers. I didn't even know how, you know, those guys were. You know, I'm not really a fan. Honestly, I know who they are. And I always mix them up with Bloodhound Gang for some reason. But, yeah, I mean, I know you're a fan of them, so.
Well, I went to high school with him and several other ex-bandmates. When I was a freshman, these guys were seniors. And Jarrett was in a band with one of my former drummer and guitar players from the band Sick Bag, and they were in a cover metal band called Terminal Seasons. And dude, I've told my old drummer Ray, who has all the VHS tapes, to upload that shit to YouTube, because Jarrett Reddick sounds just like old school Dave Mustaine. Whenever
I would never even picture it after, like, I seeing him now, I know, you know, he went through a lot of stuff, and see, you know, I after you started talking about him, you know, I look at all the shit, and the voice, I can't put the two of them, don't, it just doesn't match. It's so weird.
I'm telling you, he sounds just like old school Dave Mustaine.
That is funny. So keep the battles up on fucking Facebook. It's good for the show. That's why I asked if she knows who it is, because usually that stirs shit up for the site. And, you know, hopefully these stupid pre-roll commercials will come up. But let's get to what we're really calling it about. And that would be The Walking Dead.
Oh, last night's episode. I already fucking knew who was gonna die, bro. I already knew. Well, who was going to get bit? He's not...
Yeah, he didn't die, so technically, right.
Some co-workers at work, they're all like, oh, he's not... He didn't get bit by a walker. He just landed on that dead deer.
That's funny. That's funny.
And, you know, with the immaturity and just the slowness of the writing of the show this season, I wouldn't put it past them to say, oh, yeah, he just landed on a dead deer head.
I don't know. He looked pretty bad at the end.
Yeah, he did. He did. But yeah. He's gonna die. But you know, I thought that they were gonna do like they did last season. You know, kill off two, and I thought that they were gonna kill off Judith and Carl.
Yeah, I don't know if I might have blinked, but I know the dude Neil died. I don't know what happened when they blew up all the houses and shit there, but I mean, it's pretty good, but the way that it's transitioning to the, I know it's the mid-season, but that's not really a cliffhanger enough to bring a slam, and you know, ratings have been down, so it's not going to be. We know Carl dies. I mean, it's been talked about. I mean, they knew, you know, one of them had to go, so I mean, that's the obvious that you know, it was time for him to go anyway. He was a little pain in the ass.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to rewatch it tonight, because apparently my coworker Chad, he's a big huge fan and shit, and apparently I missed something last night. Like you said, I guess I blinked. I didn't know that Negan and Rick had a fight, and then Rick like picked up Lucille, and Negan had this big old bitch bit. I don't remember that scene, so.
Yeah.
I gotta rewatch it tonight.
Yeah, that.